good evening, everyone. My name is Wang Wei, and Wenfeng is my colleague here. So it's a pleasure to be to show our project SINGA here. I had a PY data not long ago. Yeah, it's a good place to discuss some topics, some popular topics about data science here. And this project started about one year ago in US, and we went to Apache incubator last year, and we have released three versions, and then we came to the version one. So today we're going to discuss something about the deep learning and the training systems and our version one. And you may have, actually, I don't know how many of you have low deep learning overview. So deep learning actually is very, very effective for a wide range of applications, including as a computer vision, for example, for image classification and video recognition. Actually, so before 2012, as I remember, actually in 2012, due to the image net competition, and deep learning shows the outstanding in that competition, the deep learning, especially the deep convolutional neural network, showed the outstanding performance, and it is much more accurate than traditional algorithms in computer vision area. So after that, there are many people working on deep learning and on this area. And later, the convolutional neural networks and other neural networks in deep learning was applied to other areas, outside the computer vision, including the NLP, natural language processing, to do the, for example, machine translation and the language modeling. And also include the speech recognition and games, for example, AlphaGo, which is very popular. And for us, actually, we're from a database group, so we're not machine learning guys or computer vision guys. So we don't try to improve these accuracies or to build more models, propose more other models for different applications. So our consideration, we concern more about the training. Because the deep learning is big in terms of the training data set size. For example, the ImageNet data has 1 million images, and the speech recognition models trained by Baidu and Google use a large audio data set. And another aspect, the model parameter size is very large. The model size, once the model is very large, every training iteration would cost a long time. So finally, the training would take days to complete, even on GPUs. So what we tried, our motivation of starting this project was to improve the efficiency of the systems, to make it run faster, to complete the training faster. And on the other hand, the deep learning algorithms are typically very difficult to understand. It has many layers and many different types of layers and many hyperparameters to tune. Yeah, so it requires a lot of experience. So sometimes actually in our life, the other guys in our life, they stop to train because they found it very hard to tune the hyperparameters. There are many hyperparameters to tune. And finally, one more aspect is the memory. So besides the speed, memory is another big problem, especially for large models. For example, if although the model parameter would be hundreds of megabytes, but if you consider the activations, I mean the feature of every layer and the gradients of the layer and the data set, so it would easily use up all the memory of GPU card. So here's the motivations of this project and what, yeah. And today I will give the talk, and which includes the three parts. I will give, I assume that some of you may not know deep learning very well, so I will give a brief introduction of it. And then we will discuss some optimization techniques used in other systems, existing systems, and from the our background from the database perspective. And finally is the design and the examples of our new version of SINGA. So here just shows that deep learning is very popular, it is very hot, and it's very effective. So many companies are working on this area. And it works on a wide range of data types, different types of data, audio and image and text. I will introduce a couple of deep learning models. The first type of deep learning model is called feed-forward neural nets. And I think it is the most popular or most widely used deep learning model. We can see that this one is a very simple or basic deep learning model. It is called, actually it is, it was proposed I think 20 to 30 years ago. It is called multi-layer perception. And it has multiple layers. Generally, it has multiple layers. The input layer, the hidden layers, there could be multiple hidden layers. And finally, it will have a prediction, that is the output layer. So the training of this model is like this. So you have the, this model works in this way. So the input data will be forward propagate to the output layer. And for example, this is a simple example. The input feature is this x1 and xn. And this one, the w, is the weight matrix. So that it will do a linear transformation of the input feature. And do all them are typically followed by some nonlinear transformations. So finally, it will convert this feature into a set of probabilities. So this one probability for one label. So finally, you have a probability distribution among all the possible labels. So we will select the top five or top one label as a prediction result. Another one is more popular, the convolutional neural network. It is very effective to capture the local relationship of pixels, for example, the pixels in the images. So it is in 2012, so this model won the first prize in the ImageNet competition. So convolutional neural network is a little bit similar to the multi-layer perception in the sense that it is acyclic directed graph. So it has multiple layers, the input, the convolution layers, sampling layers, and the convolution layers, and so on and so forth. So it is acyclic collected graph. But the transformation is different to the multi-layer perception. So this transformation uses the convolution operation, just as shown in this figure. So the convolution operation will use a filter or called kernel. It is, for the image, it is a squared or typically squared matrix. It will slide through the whole image and to do the convolution to get the, to transform the features. Another set of deep learning model is the recurrent neural nets. It is typically used for the time series or sequential data. For example, for machine translation or speech recognition. So this data comes in sequence. So it models the sequential relationship of the data. And typically, when we train this model, we can unroll this model. So this is the original model. So that it is a cycle. So the input data would be after the first transformation layer, the driving layer, so the hidden feature will be fit into this unit again. So, but if we unroll this model, then we can get a feed forward model. So there's no cycle, it is acyclic collective. And there are other models, for example, the energy models, for example, RBM and DBM, RBM for restricted Boltzmann machine, and the DBM for deep Boltzmann machine. So these models were very popular in, I think, after 2006 until 2012. Yeah, and recently, reinforcement learning is combined with convolutional neural networks and other deep learning models. For example, in AlphaGo, to solve other applications problems. So in the following slides, I will use the feed-forward neural nets as examples to describe some concepts. So as I said, so we care more about the training, the time and the memory cost of the training. So how to train a deep learning model? It is described as in this way, the formalized way, formula. The fx, the x is the input of, the, for example, the pixels of the image, and the y is the ground truth of label of this image. So the deep learning model, the feed-forward model, just transfers the input x into another feature representation, fx. Well, this final representation could be just be the probability distribution, a vector of probabilities. So the L is called the loss function. So it will measure the discrepancy of the prediction and the ground truth. And the theta here is the model parameters. So it denotes all the model parameters. That is to say the parameters in every layer. So it is a collection of the parameters. So the given a data set, a training data set, the objective is to minimize the average loss by changing the model parameters. So the training algorithm just updates, will just find an optimal set of parameters that will predict the ground truth label accurately. In this figure here, the input label is just the ground truth label. It is inside the training data set. And the image, so the image will be transferred to the prediction, and so this is called the forward pass, and the training would do a backward pass, and so the training is like in this way. Typically, deep learning models are training using stochastic gradient descent algorithm. There are some other variants of this algorithm. So the simple, the original SGD algorithm works in this way. The model parameters are initialized randomly for them following some Gaussian distribution or uniform distribution. And then we read the data in a mini-batch way. So the big data set will be partitioned into small mini-batches and be fed into the model. So the model will the model will compute the gradients of the parameters with respect to the loss function. And then once we have the gradients, we can update the model parameters. So this is the first order gradient. So we update the model parameters in the direction that will make the loss less in the next, make the loss smaller. And the training, the model, the training algorithm, we said that it spends a lot of time because the operations inside the, for example, the convolution layers or the in the MLP, the fully collected was called the dense layer. So there are many matrix, large matrix multiplication. So this matrix multiplication is time consuming. So finally, the training for one iteration for the whole model, I mean the one SGD iteration is time consuming. So here, this figure shows one example for the multi-layer perception. So the input data will be fed through all the layers to compute the prediction, and then backwards to compute the gradient of each parameter inside each layer. And then this parameter, the gradients will be used to update the model parameters. So this is the general idea of the SGD algorithm for training deep learning models. Yeah, we said that training procedure is time consuming. And here are some statistics of some popular convolutional neural networks for image classification applications. The training epoch means passing the scanning the whole data set once is called one epoch. Yeah, so typically it will, all these models requires to pass this data set many times. And the model parameters, the size of the model parameters is large. Okay, so here is just some basics of training deep learning models. Next, we will discuss some optimizations in terms of speed and efficiency for training deep learning models. The deep learning model consists of a set of layers. So usually we will represent a model using a set of collective layers. But during the training, there are more finer grained concepts. This training consists of a lot of small operations. These operations could be like this. So for example, the input X or some middle layer features X would be passed through the sigmoid function. So X could be a matrix or vector, and this X would be used in different different top upper layers. This is matrix multiplication and some linear algebra operations. Yeah, in this way. So one opportunity of improving the speed of these operations is to parallelize them, run them in parallel. So for example, in this example here, there are two paths. So actually we can run them in parallel because there is this operation and this operation has no data dependency. So once this operation is finished, we can run this one and this one in parallel. Yeah, so this is the operation scheduling. So if we can schedule these operations which have no data dependency to run them in parallel, then we may save time. Yeah, so this technique is used by some existing systems like Cyano, TensorFlow, and MXNet. For Cyano and TensorFlow, they are two popular deep learning softwares. They build the deep learning model statically in the sense that users will specify each layer and the model and collect these layers, and this software will generate a graph of a graph. Inside this graph, each node is an operation like this one. And these operations are collected based on their data dependency. For example, this operation has data dependency on this operation. So once this graph is constructed, they can do this analysis of this graph to do the operation scheduling, yeah, to find some passes like this to run them in parallel. Yeah, so another one, this system detects the data dependency at runtime. So all the operations will be submitted to a coordinator or something called engine. So this engine will receive the operations and detect the dependencies on time, at real time, and then schedule these operations onto different execution units. And we think that there are still other some improvements for this operation scheduling. So, for example, in the deep learning models, most of people would use GPUs to train deep learning models. And the, inside one GPU, there are many CUDA streams or kernels. So, if we can, we need to allocate or place these operations onto multiple CUDA streams. How to place these operations to maximize the throughput would be a problem, and may have some opportunities for further improvement, improve the efficiency. Yeah, so the runtime optimization can collect some statistics, for example, the running time of each operation. Yeah. And actually in database systems, we know that the SQL query is highly optimized using some heuristics and cost models. So you will estimate each scheduling or estimate each execution plan, and then select the best one to do the real execution. Yeah, for hardware, yeah, so most widely used hardware is GPU, especially from Nvidia GPU, because of the CUDN library, which can speed up the training of convolution layers and other layers in about 5 to 10 times, I think, compared with self-implemented kernels, and maybe more than 10 times faster than CPU implementation. And recently, some people said that the FPGA may have the potential to speed up the deep learning training in the sense of power consumption. So it would be more power efficient to run these deep learning models than GPU. And the FPGA is could be used in small devices, the mobile devices. And Intel also tried to speed up the machine learning algorithms using their own hardware. And the OpenCL is a language, programming language. So OpenCL works on a wide range of hardware, including Nvidia GPU, AMD GPU, XC, Scion, and the FPGA. Yeah, there are also some learning chips and instruction set. So generally, the many people working on hardware optimization, especially for deep learning models. Despite in addition of the operation scheduling hardware optimization, some people are working on distributed training. So in the sense of using a cluster of machines or multiple GPU cards to speed up the training. So for this, there are two types of parallelisms for training deep learning models. One is called model parallelism, and one is data parallelism. And for example, for this model, this is unruled version of RN model. So as we remember, the RN model can be unruled into a feed-forward neural networks. So in this way here, we have two stacks of RN layers. This is the first stack and the second one. So typically, the training the data or the four units, that would be four inputs. So these four inputs can be fed in at the same time to the model. But there are data dependency between these units, the RN units. So this one has to be done at first. And then this one and this one, these two can be done, can be run in the, at the same time. And after these two finished, these two can run. So generally we can run this one in parallel, this one in parallel, this one and this one in parallel. So we can separate these two stacks of layers into two workers. Here one worker could be one GPU. Yeah, so but there would be data transferring between the workers if we partition the model into different workers and run them at the same time. Yeah, we will discuss the overhead of the communication later. And this one is for the data parallelism, it is much easier than compared with the model parallelism. So you just partition the whole training data set at the beginning into small set, and you create the neural network structure at once, and you replicate this neural network structure onto multiple tree cards or onto multiple nodes. So it is called model replica. So each model would each node or each worker would have the same set of model parameters. So at every SGD iteration, it will read its own partition of data set and compute the gradients of on this data set, I mean for each worker. And this gradients will be sent back to a centralized parameter server. It could have multiple nodes here. And this gradients could be would be averaged, and then it would be used to update the model parameters. The updated model parameters would then be sent back to each worker. So this is called a synchronous distributed training. Another version is called asynchronous training. For asynchronous training, the gradients would be sent to the server separately. So the server, once the server receives one copy or one set of model parameter gradients, it will update the parameters immediately. So each worker, all the workers run asynchronously. Similarly, again, the overhead from the communication and the synchronization between the worker, server, and between among the workers.
So I was not clear how you're partitioning the
dataset. You can do partition the dataset evenly without overlapping.
Okay.
For example, you have 1,000 images. You can partition them onto 10 machines. Each machine would have 100 images. Yeah. Yeah. We mentioned that there are some overhead due to. From distributed training. The first one is communication. We see here the model parallelism works for this model because this model has a pattern, a specific pattern that these layers can be run in parallel. But for some models, for example, this model, there is only one single pass, so it is not like this one. This one it has two paths, so you can run them in parallel. But for this one, if you partition the model into two parts, for example, this is the original model, and you partition this layer into two partitions, then there would be communication like this. So it is wall connect wall. So there would be much communication overhead. And for this one, the communication only happens here. But for this one, this one, there are four places. And for data parallelism, so if the model size is very large, it means every time the worker will transfer a large set of data to the server. Similarly, the worker will transfer a large set of gradients to the server, and the server will send a large set of parameters. Yeah, so in terms of communication, the communication challenges, the optimization techniques would include the compression. So this is a direct solution. You compress the parameters or the data when you transfer the parameters or data. And also the hardware, the InfiniBand could be used. And the hybrid parallelism is also used to, the hybrid parallelism means that you use, for some layers you will do the model parallelism, and for some layers you may do the data parallelism. So it can save some cost, but would be much more complex. Yeah, and the synchronization overhead is another problem. So for the synchronous training, if you have many workers, so this work, the server has to wait the greetings from all the servers. So in this case, the synchronization among all the servers would be another problem. So typically, we would use 2 to 3 GPU cards on a single server. And for asynchronous training, so actually the workers run in asynchronously, but since they run, different workers would have different running speed. One worker would finish very fast, and so maybe worker A is working on the fifth iteration, and worker B is working on the 10th iteration. So this difference between the iterations is called a staleness. So once the staleness is very large, it means the workers are working on totally different versions of the parameters. So the training convergence would be a problem. Sometimes it may not even converge. So and it means that finally the model diverges. So the training diverges. So you cannot get a stable version of the model. Yeah, there are also hybrid solution. One is called the staleness bounded asynchronous training. So typically, once you find that some workers are very fast, it is 5 iterations faster than other workers, then you stop this worker, and until other workers catch up. Another one is called the training with backup workers. It means that, so it is synchronous training. But it allows, for example, for you have 100 workers. Once the server receives the greetings from 90 workers, then it will update the model parameters. So traditionally, the server has to wait all the greetings from all the workers. It means 100 workers. So in this case, once it receives the 90 greetings from 90 workers, it will continue to update the model parameters. So it will not wait for all the workers. Yeah, so next we discuss some techniques for the memory optimization. So in our group, there are many students who work on the memory, in-memory database. So there are many techniques to be adapted. So the memory of training algorithm is used by the parameter values, parameter gradients, and the layer feature values, and the layer gradients. So typically it would be four times of the parameter size, even larger. And but the GPU has a smaller memory size than CPUs. And so what we can do to save memory? There are some traditional solutions to use memory pool or use garbage collection. So for deep learning models, especially in maybe 1 or 2 years ago, the softwares will allocate the memory for each variable. Also, for every iteration, so we can see here. So for the feedforward models, the data flow would be from the bottom to the top. So in the case, some variables from the bottom layers would not be used in this iteration, so it can be freed. But yeah, so some systems would allocate this, would keep this variables for the whole life cycle. So it is a waste of memory. So if you use garbage collection, for example, in Python has this kind of technique, so it will free this memory automatically. And another technique is swapping. So we know that GPU has a limited memory, but CPU has larger memory. So we can swap the memory, the variables between GPU and CPU. So it is
also very specific for some specific models, especially for the very deep neural networks. So the variables of the bottom layer would be used in a num time, after num time, because you have to forward propagate to the top layers. So these bottom layers variables, for example, its parameters would be used in a num time. I mean, once it propagate to the top and then back and comes back. So in this case, the parameters could of the bottom layers could be swapped to the CPU. And when we want to use it, and we swap it back to the GPU. So this is called swapping. And another technique is called dropping variables. So this some variables, so because it's forward propagation and backward propagation, during forward for one layer, after it's forward propagation, we can drop its variables. Although it would be used later, we can drop it. So we can select some layers and drop their variables, but we do not drop all the variables of all the layers. We just select some to drop. And then later when we want to use it, we recompute this variable. It is like the redo operation or failure recovery in database. So in database, you have the log, so you know how to compute the record. You have the transaction records, so you know how to compute the record of one time point based on the previous checkpoint files or some other persistent storage. So in this case, some variables are in GPU memory. So you can use these variables to compute some dropped variables. So this is called a variable dropping. So actually, all this can be done in runtime. Because the iteration, the SG iteration, for every SG iteration, the computation, the pattern, the data flow is the same. So the order of the operations are the same. So after a few iterations of warm up iterations, you know when this variable would be used again, and then you can estimate, you can schedule the dropping or swiping operations in this way that I can select this a subset of variables, an optimal subset of variables to drop, to swipe, and you can estimate when to swipe the variables from CPU to GPU. Yeah, you can do some cost modeling to estimate the time, the best time to drop, swipe, yeah, swipe in, swipe out. Yes?
What do you think, when you work this in Python, with the benefit you get from doing what you just said, reusing the variables and so on, if you were to instead take certain parts of the program and do those parts in C instead, how would these two balance? Would it be better to say Python is by definition not very efficient in handling certain operations? That's why some parts of the Python programs, they convert it, so like NumPy, for example, I know a lot of that is actually converted, so it's more closer to C. Would that be a way of doing it also?
Is there a problem about the Python, the language problem?
Yeah, you sounded like, maybe I misunderstood you, but you sounded a bit like you would try to take Python as it is, as an interpreted language, and try to do some magic with the variables to gain some efficiency. And I was just thinking, maybe that's also what I would do. But then I thought, okay, but maybe it's better to take those crucial parts and then have them do that in more low-level language, and then you use it as modules in Python. Would that be worth doing, or?
I think these optimizations are very specific to the deep learning models.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, you can, if you want to use deep learning as a black box, then this operation, these optimizations would be low-level optimizations. The users would not need to care about these things. Yeah. So because we are developing the software, so we think these optimizations, we should do these optimizations for the users. So the users would not need to care about these low-level optimizations. So we try to do this automatically.
So users would not need to know the underlying part, the low-level optimizations. I think it is like the garbage collection was on optimizations in Python. So the Python will do these things automatically, and the users will not need to know how the memory is managed.
Right. Okay. But it just sounds very complex the way you explain it. So then I thought, okay, this anyway going to be complex. Maybe I just had the idea it's better to just super optimize it and then you make the black box you talked about.
I think depends on who the errors you are working on. So you just want to use deep learning, then you don't care about the low-level optimizations. I mean, you don't want to do this low-level optimizations, right? You want to use the black box.
So what languages? So SINGA is basically implemented in C++, right?
Yeah. We have the Python binding or Python wrappers. Yeah.
So basically, it's already in C.
It is already in C.
Yeah, they're binders basically, and CUDA is also it's even lower level than that.
Here is an overview or comparison of the existing systems. We do not care of every aspect of them, but just the optimizations we mentioned in the previous slides, including parallelized operations. The operation scheduling. We know that actually TensorFlow and Theano, they have the ability to do this kind of optimization, but we don't know that they haven't shown the details of whether they have done it or not. We know that the MXNet has done this one. For Torch Cafe currently, I think it is very hard to do this kind of this low level optimizations because they are based on not the tensor level. I mean the operations we talk about the tensor operations. So Cafe and Torch are based on more like a layer level. Also, Torch has tensor operations. The execution plan tooling, a company none of them has done. The memory swiping, some of them have done. But was done manually. So we think there could be some opportunities to do it automatically. Generally, we mean that there are some opportunities for optimizing the deep learning training systems from this aspect.
What is consistency?
Consistency, we mean the synchronous or asynchronous training.
Oh, okay.
So here is the brief progress of SINGA. At the initial stage, we think that distributed training would be very important for this deep learning models because deep learning models use a lot of memory and CPU and GPU. So for the first version, V0.1 to V0.3, we focused on distributed training. But later we found that not everyone would use distributed training, especially for some data scientists and some data science experts. So they just want to use deep learning as a black box. For the version 1.0, we redesigned some parts to optimize this things like as a black box and provide some easier user interface for users to use. For single GPU training, I mean standalone training. So we'll give some details here. So for the previous version, we have this neural net and layer abstractions, which are inherent to the deep learning models. For example, we use this layer abstractions to create the feedforward models. There are models, so we can unroll them into a feedforward model. Also for the energy models. And we can do partitioning for distributed training.
different partition methods. And for distributed training, different approaches, synchronous training, asynchronous training, and hybrid training were implemented in the previous version. And we proposed a flexible architecture to conduct different distributed training frameworks, synchronous, asynchronous, and the popular training algorithms. Yeah, here are some experiments we did before on the CPU and the GPU machines. Generally, previously we showed that for some models, not every model, if you use more machines or more GPUs or more CPUs, it would increase the speed. Yeah, and this is one GPU, but not very a good GPU. So if you use more CPUs, you can beat it. And this one we trained on a single node and in a cluster. So here we noticed that the training was not very stable due to the staleness we mentioned before. So once you have more workers, so the staleness would be larger. So that would affect the convergence. And later we did some more experiments for using the GPU machine and GPU cluster. And this figure shows the training on a single node with 1, 2, 3 GPU cards. So we see that our system is performs well, and it is compatible with other systems for single node multiple GPU cards. But for the distributed training, I mean in a GPU cluster, so we found the problem. For this model, the AlexNet model, it is a very large model, has a large set of parameters. So it means that communication overhead is very large. So this is the performance for a single worker, and that is to say a single node. And this one for 2 nodes and 4 nodes. We can see that the performance is bad for multiple nodes. So this is caused by the communication. So we tried another model. We compare it for the TensorFlow, the case is the same. We tried another model. This model has a very little parameter set, but its computation is very high. The computation cost is very high. So the communication overhead is small, but the computation cost is high. So in this case, if we do distributed training, we would have more. The performance would be better.
Node
means one machine.
Machine.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is one machine and this 4 machines. Yeah.
That's four different CPUs.
They have the same configuration for the CPU and GPU. Yeah.
And number of workers, it says.
Number of workers here means the number of GPU cards. One GPU card will one worker will run on one GPU card.
Okay, so with 4 nodes you have 4 workers, one for each.
Yeah, one here for this experiment we run one machine with one GPU card.
Yes.
And here is the software stack for the new version. So we tried to make it general or extensible to support the optimizations techniques we mentioned before. So we have the low-level abstractions, including device and tensor. So for device, it is a general abstract which would support different hardware, including the CPU, GPU, FPGA, from other hardware. So how we implement it? So we have the different specific devices, the CPU device and the GPU device using CUDA, the programming language, and using OpenCL. So OpenCL could also be used for other devices besides a GPU. And for the tensor, we implement different set of mathematical or linear algebra operations for different devices. So we can operate the tensors on different hardware devices in this way. And on top of this core module components, there are some other components that are specific for machine learning or deep learning models. The layer for module for the deep learning models, an initializer for initialized machine learning, the parameters in machine learning models, and the loss functions, the metrics and optimizers. And also this part would be the IO part. It includes the data read and writing and network communication, message transferring. Yeah, so for this new version, we want to support a general machine learning algorithms applications through the tensor abstraction. And we try to support different hardware and do some runtime optimization for speed and memory. And also we will continuously support the distributed training from previous versions. So the final one is a product we are trying to build, try to make deep learning as a service. That is to say, we train some models, but typically the companies or the users actually want to use deep learning instead of train deep learning. So they want to use the pre-trained models to in the applications. So this service would built in some popular deep learning models. So what the users would do is just to provide us the data. We will respond to you with the prediction result. So it is just like a black box. So we will manage the training and the other things. So you just give me the data and I will respond to you with the result.
So if you're not regarding that, how do I transfer the data to you? Do you have, yeah?
It is like API.
So
we will provide the API or RESTful API, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we will.
Do you have them have that within the cloud service?
Cloud service. So if we run the servers on Amazon or on the cloud, then it will be the cloud services.
But the thing is that when you do data transfers across to an API call,
mm-hmm.
the cost is huge, especially if you're moving large amounts of data. So you kind of have to be really, it's more practical from a cost point of view, it's within the cloud silo.
I think the data that for deep learning models, the training data set is very large, but at runtime, I mean, after you deploy this model, the data would come continuously, not so it would be smaller than the training data. For example, for image classification, every time you may send me one or two images,
mm-hmm.
right? That is a relatively smaller.
So you're selling the learned models, not without the training, basically.
No, I mean for this one.
Yeah.
For this one, there are two scenarios. One is that I have trained a good image classification model, so you just send me the images you want to enable. Yeah, another case is that I know how to train an image classification model, but I don't have the data. You have the data, so I will train the model for your data. Yeah, for the second case, so we may manage the data offline, so you pass me the data in some way, and then I train the model.
Yeah,
it's
not super practical.
Yeah, so or you just upload the data onto S3 or Amazon storage. Yeah, then I will fetch the data. Yeah, I can run it on Amazon EC2 services, and I can access S3, then I can do it. Yeah.
Okay. Can I ask you, this service, the reason you want to do it like this, is it because the training and the configuration is actually an expert job? It needs you or someone similar to you to set it up, or is it because you want to keep the source code for all this closed, or will it be open source, or what's the?
So actually the SINGA code is open source. So for this part, we think that not everyone want to tune hyperparameters, to debug the deep learning models. So we want to make it easier and convenient for layman, for normal users. Yeah. Yeah, here are some applications I will go through quickly. So the Flock project is a project in our group. So it will try to do food image recognition to recognize the nutrition, to recognize food and then to respond users with the nutrition facts inside this image by combining with a knowledge base with nutrition facts. And another one is for malware detection. Yeah, we have some malware data set, so we'll do some classification. So deep learning, it is used for, it is good at computer vision and some errors. So we're not sure whether it is good for malware detection, but we just try. We're trying to do it. And for healthcare data, for some disease progression modeling and something, for the time series data. And this one for some location, the spatial temporal data, we try to predict the congestion of roads. Yeah, some other I will skip. So here's the conclusion. So deep learning is effective but hard to train or optimize. And so we discuss some optimization techniques from other systems or existing systems and from our perspective, from the database perspective. Yeah, so we didn't talk about this one. And yeah, so we are working on optimizing this speed memory. Yeah, and some other things. Okay, thank you. Do I have the time to show the tutorial? If not, okay. And it's not a tutorial, actually just some simple demo. Yeah, we build the, sorry, oh, okay. Okay, so we build the core part in C++, and for the model components, the layer, initializer, optimizer, something, we use the Python. We have the Python binding and the wrappers. So here, so we have the tensor abstract, the device optimizer, and these things in Python. So we can, I will show some simple examples here. So this first example is very simple. We just try to find, we will have a line, and around this line, I will generate some data points. So I may run it and to show it. This is the first time I use the Python notebook. I'm not sure. Can I help you too?
5 minutes break while the speaker is trying to get things up, then probably we come back here at 8:18 after 5 minutes.
So that'll be in your So I do a deep learning workshop thing. We're using Theano and Lasagna, and I haven't been able to, and I give out a USB stick so that people can run it on virtual machines. No, I didn't do it in TensorFlow, because TensorFlow wants all the memory.
Okay.
It's very...
So you mean memory of the CPU or GPU?
Yeah, so because it's on a virtual thing, I can only use like 2 gig of memory.
Okay.
How does TensorFlow is very casual with the matter?
We noticed that I think TensorFlow, I mean, it has the potential to do some optimization, but we haven't done it.
I think the Google's machines are just selling the big machines.
Maybe.
It's yours.
Yeah, actually, we will do, but company, to be honest, we haven't done much optimization. Yeah, so we mentioned in
the framework.
Yeah. So maybe for the next version. Okay, here are some demos of using the Python interface to run Singa functions. Well, firstly, I will show a simple demo. So for this demo, I will generate some data. And here, this is the boundary, and there are two set of data, just two labels. And we will try to build a model to a simple multilinear perception model to classify the data. So what we did, what we will do here. So first, I will set the boundary, and then I will generate the data for the there are two data sets. One is called positive set, another one is called negative set. So I will generate these two sets just as the dots here. This one and this one. And after that, I will initialize the model. The model has a linear transformation layer. So linear transformation layer, it has a width matrix. So I will randomly initialize the width matrix. And it has a bias vector. So I will also set it as zero. And then I will call this train layer. So this layer will first, it will convert the data. The data, each data point has x and y value. So it is a two-dimensional data. And here there are, I think it has 30 data points. So I will convert it. The shape of DAT is 30 and 2, 30 rows and 2 columns. And it will convert the NumPy array into a Singa tensor. So this is for the data, and this is the label. And here, the layered engine will set the engine of the layer. So it means, for each layer, there are many different implementations, as we mentioned, for CPU, for GPU, using CUDA, using OpenCL. So we just set the engine here. So this one means we will use the CPP version. And we will create one layer. This layer will do the linear transformation. It will multiply the input feature with the width matrix, the parameter, and add the bias vector. So after that, we will do a nonlinear transformation. It is called activation. So we use the sigmoid or logistic
transformation function. So we set, we construct these two layers, and then we, oh, so actually I initialize the parameters here. So initialize the parameters following a Gaussian distribution, and initialize the bias vector to be zero. And the optimizer, the optimization algorithm, SGD, so I will set the set up the optimization algorithm and the loss function. So all of these are the necessary components for training a deep learning model. The optimizer, the loss function, the layers, and the parameter initialization. Then I will do five iterations. So for each iteration, I will forward the training data through each layer, the dense layer, the activation layer, and then the loss function, the loss layer. So I will get a loss value. And then I will backward the gradients from the top to the bottom layers. And then I get the gradient for each layer, and here this one is the gradients for the parameters in the dense layer. Then I will apply the optimizer to update the parameters. So this is the parameter gradients, and this is the parameter value, and it's just a tag for this parameter. I will do the update, and then I will show the plot. So this is the original graph, the original data points. So the different color represents different labels. So here I will, this is the first iteration. So you see some data points are misclassified. Actually, this data points should be red color. So it is misclassified as blue. So yeah, so it's just a simple example. You may need to tune the parameters to make the data points are colored as this one. This is a ground truth. This is ground truth. And this is a prediction of the model we train. So you can tune the hyperparameters. Here shows the loss values. Generally, we want to train the models to make the loss smaller and smaller. So you see this, the first iteration, second one, and it is decreasing. We can see that there are many hyperparameters to tune. How to initialize the model parameters? From the Gaussian distribution or uniform distribution. And the learning rate of the SGD algorithm, it means the change update step of the when you update the model parameters. There are many hyperparameters to tune, and how many iterations to run. So this is a simple example. And next, I will show you.
Can I ask a couple quick questions? Okay. Firstly, do you support any kind of sparse eugenic matrices?
Currently, we only use the dense tensor.
Full rank tensor.
Yeah.
And your tensors are basically just multi-dimensional arrays.
Multi-dimensional arrays.
Any kind of what's it called now? Regularization.
Yes, we can set the regularization. I think here we can set the weight decay. For example, the weight decay coefficient. We can usually it would be small, a small number. So the weight decay is a coefficient of the regularizer, L2 regularizer.
L2.
How
about L1?
L1, it is another thing. It is called regularizer. So you can add a regularizer here. So currently we use L2 regularizer. We implement L2. You can implement, I mean it is customizable. Can provide another one.
And your activation functions are all predefined, right? You can't customize
here. This one, this is one layer. It is a built-in layer. So here it could be sigmoid, or tangent edge, or RELU, some others.
Yeah. So you can't have a custom function that.
You have to implement a new layer. This one is a This RBM model was used in around 2006, after 2006, to initialize deep learning models. So it is actually a shallow model that has only two layers. So we will show here. This is not a feed-forward model. It uses another training algorithm to compute the parameter gradients. So I will not show the details, but just write. Maybe I just show. Yeah, generally, it will follow the same flow of setting the layers. For this example, it will do tensor operations directly, multiply, add row, and these operations. Yeah, so we'll have the optimizers and the loss functions, and so on. So yeah, there are some. I think that I will try to write. This is a matplotlib problem. Yeah, I don't know much about that, but I can show you here some results. So this this one. So this is the weight matrix, the weight matrix in the layer. So this is a randomly initialized weight matrix, the first one. And this is after the first iteration, and this one, see. So generally it shows that the model is trying to learn some patterns through the weight matrix. And we try to run, you see the pattern would be clear after you run for more iterations. And one more, I think. Yeah, for this one, I will just show you how to create a convolutional neural network in a simple way to construct the neural net using Python. Actually, Python is really good for these things. Previously, we used C++, it is very, the code looks very ugly. So currently, it's much better. You see, here we will add the layers. This is a feed-forward net, as we mentioned before. So you will add the layers, and here is just a function. So this one will add multiple layers. So add layer, add different layers, and different layers will have different hyperparameters. So just in this way, we can then, so load the data and conduct training. So it's the same. And I want to show you one interesting. This is the RN model. We have already trained the RN model. This RN model is trained over the Linux kernel code. So it is the model is on from other people. So we just retrain it and show that we can do it using Singa's Python binding. So this is after training, we will using this model to sample, to generate the data. So we can see, we'll write again. So what we did is that, so we want to generate 100 characters, and we will provide a seeding characters like this. So because this model is trained over the Linux kernel code, so the data it will generate will be like the Linux kernel code. So here, it is called a language model. So the R model would capture the sequential relationship. So actually we inputted the first five characters. So it will generate in this way. Yeah, so the generated one, and we move that again. So so this one looks better. Right, so we'll move on again. So this one actually, the first three lines from the grammar is correct, I think. So that's all for this one. Just want to show some Python code. Thank you very much.
Before we go on to the second speaker, is there any questions for Wei Wang?
infra are you running this on?
Sorry?
Infrastructure.
Sorry?
Infrastructure.
Infrastructure, or do you mean the platform, the hardware?
Is this cloud?
Yeah, it's Amazon. We run on Amazon and collect it through the Python notebook.
Amazon. Okay.
AWS.
So this is just, basically one of the AWS with the GPU units.
Yes.
And do you have it dockerized or you're not dockerized?
Docker.
Yeah.
Docker.
Yeah, containerized, sorry.
We haven't prepared the Docker.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you have them as images, as in AWS images, or?
Yeah, we just created this one yesterday, so we haven't published it.
Yeah.
Maybe later we will publish it.
Okay.